In this lecture, we'll learn about the two types of star clusters and how we measure ages of star clusters. All stars are born from giant clouds of gas. Because a single cloud can contain enough material to form many stars, stars usually form in groups. These groups are known as star clusters, and in addition to being some of the most beautiful objects in the night sky, they are also very useful to astronomers. The reason star clusters are so useful is because first, all the stars in a cluster lie at about the same distance from Earth. And second, all the stars in a cluster formed at about the same time. Astronomers can therefore use star clusters as laboratories for comparing the properties of stars that all have similar ages. There are two basic types of star clusters, the moderately sized open clusters and the densely packed globular clusters. Open clusters are found in the disk of the galaxy and tend to be young in age. They can contain up to several thousand stars and typically are about 30 light years across. Globular clusters are found in the halo of the galaxy, and their stars are among the oldest in the universe. A globular cluster can contain more than 1 million stars concentrated in the shape of a ball, typically from 60 to 150 light years across. One of the most famous open clusters is the Pleiades, a grouping of stars in the constellation of Taurus. 47 Tucanae is an example of a globular cluster. It's almost 17,000 light years away from Earth. What's really neat is that we can use star clusters as clocks. We can determine cluster ages by plotting their stars on an HR diagram. Consider the Pleiades. Most of the stars in the Pleiades are on the main sequence, with one exception. At the upper end of the main sequence, stars trail away to the right. It's these stars right here. That means that the hot, short-lived stars of spectral type O are missing from the main sequence. The Pleiades cluster is old enough for its main sequence O stars to have already ended their hydrogen-fusing lives, but young enough that some of its stars of spectral type B still reside on the hydrogen-fusing main sequence. The precise point on the HR diagram at which a cluster of stars diverges from the main sequence is called the main sequence turnoff point. For the Pleiades, it occurs around spectral type B6. The main sequence lifetime of a B6 star is roughly 100 million years, so this must be the age of the Pleiades. Any star in the Pleiades that was born with a main sequence spectral type hotter than B6 had a lifetime shorter than 100 million years and is no longer found on the main sequence. Over the next few billion years, the B stars in the Pleiades will die out, followed by the A stars and the F stars. If we could make an HR diagram for the Pleiades every few million years, we would find its main sequence gradually growing shorter. This figure compares the main sequence of other open clusters. In each case, the age of the cluster is equal to the lifetime of the stars at its main sequence turnoff point. The older the cluster is, the more stars that have turned off the main sequence, and the redder its turnoff point. Just to say it one more time, the age of the cluster is equal to the lifetimes of the stars at its main sequence turnoff point. This technique of identifying main sequence turnoff points is a very powerful tool that allows us to determine the age of star clusters. We've discovered that globular clusters are about 13 billion years old, making them the oldest known objects in the galaxy. We'll talk more about star clusters when we talk about the Milky Way. That's it for Chapter 15. Take care, enjoy your day or your night. I'll talk to you soon.